Hello and welcome to channelfireball.com. My name is Caleb Durward, recording here for you now. I'm going to run this blue-black control shell through a standard daily for you folks. I'm a little bit rusty, haven't done a constructed video in a while, but I am excited. I've been excited about this deck for a minute now. I wrote a couple of articles about it, and my most recent article has a list that's very, very similar to this one. And there's only a couple of tweaks, so I'm not going to go too deep into the particulars of each individual card. A lot of these cards are very straightforward, and if you're curious about a particular card choice, you can go and check it out in my article. I will say that one of the reasons that I like this variant of blue-black over, like, say, classic blue-black control is that you have a lot more to do in the early game. You've got these hangerback walkers, the Clash of Wills, which can act as a turn 2 counterspell, and then the Blau Blights like usual. But that means that you're interacting with the opponent and you're developing a board presence long before typical blue-black control would ever do that. And the hangerback walkers in particular have been sweet at stimming aggro and buying time to find a sweeper. And the sweepers in this deck are pretty good, even though I've only got like three of them. The two Languish and the Aether Spouts. Aether Spouts works really well alongside the Thopter Spy Network because you're hitting the opponent, you're drawing cards, the opponent has to attack, they have to pressure your life total, and then Aether Spouts is just kind of game-winning. And both of them bridge the gap between the early mid-game, both of them being Languish and Aether Spouts, to the late game, where you have Ugin to mop things up again. Just the most inevitability-est card ever, especially when you're playing a deck with seven counterspells. So a couple of tweaks that I'm trying out in this daily that I've not tried before, so don't hate on me if they turn out to be bad. I'm not confident in these couple of card choices that I'm trying out, but one of them is I'm trying out a main deck Orbs of Warding, which is something that I've wanted to try for a while. But I think it'll be interesting. I think he has almost enough application to be main deckable. The You Have Hexproof line is really good against opposing Ashiok, against opposing Thoughtseizes. Blue-Black Control is a deck where, well into the late game, if the opponent draws a Thoughtseize, it's still very good against you. Because you have all these draw cards, like, you need to be able to hold your counters in your hand for your deck to be effective. So they're trying to, like, Den Protector and get back Thoughtseize and stuff, and Orbs of Warding stops that and lets you protect your hand at a certain point. Otherwise, the Hexproof is relevant. Obviously, against Mono Red, I'm a little bit unsure of how large of a metagame presence Mono Red has on Moto, but it just did very well at the Pro Tour. So I like having an out to it. We don't have very much life gain in the main deck, and so there's a chance we could just get burnt out of the game by Mono Red. And even the Blue-Red Thopter deck is playing 4 Shrapnel Blast, so being able to, like, dig and find an Orbs of Warding so that you don't have to counter every single spell that they cast at a certain point seems like it could be useful in that sense. If a creature would deal damage to you, prevent one of that damage is pretty effective against a few different threats in the format. Hangerback Walker, you can just, like, kill it, and then the 1/1s can't deal you any damage. Elspeth, the 1/1s can't deal you any damage. So on and so forth. Xenagos, like a 2/2 only dealing you 1 damage as opposed to 2 damage, just makes that way less of a clock, way less of a serious threat than it normally would be. Obviously, it's not very good against larger threats like Dragonlord Atarka or Siege Rhino, cards that are just chunking you down very quickly, but it could be good. Hordling Outburst, if people are still playing that. And then the one other tweak that I made was I wanted to try out a second Dragonlord's Prerogative, which was really good for me the last time I played the deck. It was like my MVP. One of the things that I like about this style of blue-black is that a lot of the lands are actually half spells, like Dismal Backwater gains you life, Temple of Deceit scries, even the Darksteel Citadel. At a certain point, like if your opponent, like, clears away your Hangerback Walkers, or all of your Thopter tokens, or say you're just, like, entering the mid game for some reason without already having an artifact, sometimes you want to draw the Darksteel Citadel very late into the game. And so drawing raw cards instead of filtering, which in a normal control deck, at a certain point, you don't want to draw lands anymore, and filtering becomes very important. This deck still wants to hit its land drops, still wants to be able to cast Ugin on time, so on and so forth. That said, having 2 6-mana draw spells might be excessive. It might be better that one of these is a dragon, is a Jace's Ingenuity, which is the 5-mana draw 3, or it'll probably go back to the second dig through time, I'm not sure. And then the sideboard has a couple of tweaks based on my last article. I'm trying out the Annuls, which I think is going to be really good against the Blue-Red Thopter deck. And then Silumgar's just been an all-star lately. I'm up to 3 Ashioks. I found room for a third Ashiok. You only need 2 for the matchups where you need Ashiok, but it's it's really good. It's one of your better cards in those matchups. And so I don't think I'll hate having a third one around. Anyway, with no further ado, let's get into some matches. I would love to show you guys how this deck plays against a segment of the field. Yeah. Time for round one.
Hey guys, how's it going? Welcome to round one. Here we are on the play. And we have a good hand. Not the best thing ever. We would really like to have something to do on turn 2/3. The Dissolve, Hero's Downfall, and whatnot. On the other hand, we have an Artifact and a Thopter Spy Network. We have a Sweeper, and we've got really good mana. We have a Scryland, so it's a good hand. It's a good hand. Alright. Show me the good stuff. Oh, heck yes. That is perfect. Yeah, all we really needed was something to do on turn 2 or 3, and we got that with this little guy. To you, sir, to you. And now even if we don't draw anything to do this next turn, we have something to do. We can just activate this hanger bank. It looks like our opponent is playing that that green-white enchantment deck from the Pro Tour, which is fine. It's an okay deck, I guess. We have a pretty good matchup against it, because they don't apply too much early pressure. Yeah, that's exactly what he's doing. I guess I should have played my Swamp so I could Bioblight this thing. I forgot they had anything worth Bioblighting. I would have assumed that he would play this on turn 2. Maybe he just drew it. Another Ram, sure. I can, like, Banishing Light this if he has a Banishing Light, I guess. Basically, the way the matchup works is we try and relieve pressure, keep his best enchantments from resolving, and draw some cards. And then eventually, we would like to... Yep, there's the Banishing Light. Definitely removing the Thopter Spy Network. If he removes the Hangar Back Walker, we're still going to be drawing, making tokens and drawing cards because we have the Darksteel Citadel, so... That's correct. Now when we eventually find an Ugin and down ticket, though, we will be able to get back the creature generator. Thopter Spy Network. So I'm just going to Bioblight this thing. I'm just going to Bioblight this and run out of a Hangar Back Walker, I guess. Or maybe just activating is better. Get this up to a 5/5 and start attacking. I don't know. I could also attack this turn and then Languish. And then I'll eat the Nyx Fleece Ram and a Herald. The problem is that I don't actually care about his Rams that much. On the other hand, it's a way better use of my mana, I think. Alright, I'm just gonna cast this and run out another hanger back for one. Huh. Alright, well. Same thing, I guess. So he gets to pad his life total, but I get to not care that much. By doing this as on his first main phase, we're not representing Clash of Wills, but that's kind of nice now because we actually drew the Clash of Wills. Yeah, counter spells are real important in this matchup. Because he only has a few cards that actually matter. Yeah, I guess that countering that one's fine. Krivix's Insight can be a beastly card to try and trade off with. What he really needs is lands, so wouldn't have helped him that much, I suppose. Nice. Really like drawing a dissolve here. Yeah, we'll just pass again. A couple more land drops. We could hit a couple more land drops and fire off this Dragon Lords. This is a game where it's looking like Dig Through Time would end up being better. Definitely letting this thing resolve. And then do we want a Hero's Downfall this at his end of turn? Depends on if we want to languish or not. We could like attack with both of these and he blocks one and we languish. It's like the same line that we had before. I don't really want to tap out on my turn, so. Not anymore. Not now that we have this dissolve. Multiple dissolves. I can dig it. Alright, attack for five, I guess. Yeah, so if this Dragon Lords was a dig, we would actually be able to cast it in this situation. And that's like the main upside to dig over Dragon Lords, but suspension field. Toughness, three or greater. I think we just let that resolve. Play for the long game. Go ahead, man. It's all you. I'm close to wanting to cast that as a sorcery. Not quite, though. So opponent's down to four cards. Basically, you want to be in a situation where you have more counters than they have actual cards in hand. I think I'm actually just going to counter this. Another hanger back on top. I'm going to bottom this one. Hanger back, not the key to the matchup, believe it or not. Yeah, so one reason that I like Dragon Lords more is that even if I did fire off a dig at 4 mana, I'd probably be looking for land drops so that I can like cast the Ugin that I'm trying to draw into. And since I just want like raw cards, it makes more sense to have a split between the Epiphany and the Prerogative, but not super. I do want some amount of Dig Through Time. I'm not sure if I want that amount to be 2 or 1 though, with the split with the Dragon Lords. The way this game is playing out, the Dragon Lords is still gonna be pretty good. He's down to 3 cards in hand. There's our Dig Through Time. Right when we hit 6 for the Dragon Lords anyway. Just gonna attack. Opponent's got 3 cards in hand and he's not like casting anything. Makes me think that those 3 cards are cards that are just like really not good in this matchup. Like not applicable. Because if he could play something to draw cards, he would probably be doing that. If he'd be playing something to bait out counters, he would probably be doing that. Definitely countering this. Do I want this? I probably do, yeah. Then I can both dig and dissolve on the same turn with the extra blue source. Assuming that's something that I even want to do. Whittling him down, man. 2 points of damage a turn. How about that? Yeah, Crux of Fate would be pretty good. But just clearing away the Nyx Police Rams. Eventually, I'll just cast an Ugin. Yeah. So I'm fetching first here. I don't want to upset my scry with the fetch land. I'm Not that it really matters, because I'm going to be casting Dig anyway. Maybe I should have Digged first. Dug. Dig Dug. Do I even want this card? Does this do anything in this matchup? I don't think it does. Alright, so I'm going to grab Dragon Lords and a Temple of Deceit. That seems solid. Bottom all this nonsense. Ugin, how about that, eh? We have 7 lands in play, too. Probably bottom that guy. And we have a second Dugan in the deck, so we can afford to get the first one banishing lit. Just gonna pass. Fire off the Dragon Lords. Here it's actually a really good thing if he like goes to resolve another Sigil of the Empty Throne or what have you, because it's just more cards that we can eat with the Ugin downtick. This is unfortunate because getting back Hangerback Walkers isn't particularly exciting. Earlier I was thinking about saving that Hero's Downfall when I pointed it at his, I think it was like his second Herald or something like that. Or maybe it was Bobblehead. I burned a Hero's Downfall somewhere along the line. And saving that for in response to a suspension field, kill my Hangerback Walker, maybe not that bad of a line in this matchup. Anyway. Cast, not revealing anything. Revealing things is for suckers, man. It's a sucker game. Draw some cards. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. So we could just Ugin down tick. Minus three. And then we would still have the... He's only got one, two, three, four, five, six mana. So he can't play the 5 mana enchantment that gets back enchantments and a Banishing Light for the Ugin. So it's a pretty safe cast here. If he had more lands in play, and I thought he might be setting up for this Ugin, then I'd be a little bit more cautious. I would wait until I could cast it with like a Dissolve or something as backup, but this is pretty good. Those poor Hangerbacks, man. Should have hung back more. That's all there is to it. But now there's just not really much he can do. Yeah, there's the Starfield. So the Starfield's going to give him back something, right? Yeah, but he only has Sigil and Eidolon, so like, that's not really scary at all. We can counter whatever he casts on his next turn. Yeah, I'm just going to move to discard. Just bin one of these languishes. He gets returned something. Might even beat the Eidolon. We'll see. Yeah, he realizes that the Sigil is not going to win the game by itself, so he'd rather draw a card and try and develop some amount of board synergy to deal with my Ugin. Silk Wrap? Yeah, I don't care about that. Oh, he's going to draw a card. That's right. I suppose I should have Bile Blighted the Eidolon, I guess. The thing I could have done. It's not like the Eidolon draw matters that much, but it's also not like this Bile Blight that's sitting in my hand matters either. And even though we're gonna be discarding, I'm gonna fire this off. So that removes my own Thopter Spy Network, but I don't actually care. like even a little bit, like the Ugin's just gonna end the game super slowly, but you know, can't have everything, right? Yeah, hopefully he just concedes. The matchup is pretty over at this point. Do I counter that? I don't think I counter that. Nope, draw a card. I have so many extra cards that it just doesn't matter at all. I will kill it in response to another random enchantment this time, though. Like, if he plays another Silk Wrap for my Thopter. At this point, I'm not in a position where I'm going to be down ticking to Ugin to eat the Eidolon anyway. He doesn't have any mana floating. Rawr. Such downfalls. We get to draw a card immediately here. Yeah, I probably shouldn't have even played my land first there. Because I'm going to be drawing a card and maybe I have to draw like a scry land, you know? Little bit sloppy. I haven't played Moto in a minute. Draws me Epiphany. Yeah, I'm just gonna pass. We might need all of our mana for a Clash of Wills, so. Yeah, that's another thing about wanting raw cards as opposed to card filtering, is that once we reach the top end of our curve, like, we want to be able to Clash of Wills and counter whatever it is that the opponent is playing. So it very much matters that we're running, like, say, Artificer's Epiphany as opposed to Anticipate. So the way that Thopter Spy Network works is you get an individual trigger for each one. So I'm going to get to draw two cards here. Of course, if you hit them with like 10 tokens, you're still only going to draw the two cards. One for each. But that's fine. And despite my opponent gaining life for so long in the early game, he's down to 20 currently. And we are generating Thopters. It's also not a May ability, the draw on Thopter Spy Network. And every once in a while, you get to the point where you just end up down-ticking the Ugin so you can attack with your Thopters. Right now we have 16 cards left in our library. We can probably hit them here, and then next turn we have to down-tick Ugin to attack. I think he's either hoping that we deck ourselves, or I don't know. I don't know what he's hoping for. Or time out. Like, we're down to 14 minutes, I suppose. Try playing faster. Just gonna let that resolve. Six cards enter the revealed.
He gets an Eidolon of Blossoms and a Nyxfleece Ram.
I'm okay with that. That is acceptable. Do I counter this? I don't think I do. Should have done this a while ago. The old always yields, speeds up your turn a little bit. Just a matter of finishing things up. 13 cards left in the library. Yeah, that's fine. You can draw a couple more. Find another hard counter. Cool. Yeah, so 13 minutes for games 2 and 3 is not very many, but the matchup doesn't really get better for him post-board. He just has way too many dead cards to deal with. We have a few, but we get to take them out. That's nice. Thoughtseize and Ashiok are probably our best cards post-board that we're boarding in here. Get you in there. We're playing three Ashioks here. This negate, get a couple of annuls in there. Annul, really good, but it's also, on the other hand, just another negate, you know? Aether Spouts, not very good. Languish, not very good. Spot removal, okay. You generally don't want to, you don't want to have to burn your hard counters on stuff like Eidolon, so having some amount of spot removal is alright. You don't want very much, though. Like, we were kind of swamped with it that last game. At a certain point, it just builds up in your hand. You know. And that game went pretty much how it should. You play a Thopter Spy Network, they Banishing Light it, you eventually find a Nugin, nuke the board, get your Thopter Spy Network back, they can't really recover. You just draw too many cards. And you have too many ways of controlling how they draw cards. Like, you can just say no to them, and they don't have the same luxury in return. Think about cutting a Thopter Spy Network in this matchup, like just one. Or maybe a hanger back. I don't know. We'll try this. Then on the play, I'll probably bring it back in for another Hero's Downfall. So this is not a good hand in this matchup, but we're still just going to keep it. Not something you mulligan either. The cards that you're looking for in your opener, post-board, the best cards, are cards like Clash of Wills, Dissolve, Thoughtseize, Ashiok. Hanger Backwater is something to do on turn two, but it's not like something that matters that much. Pretty glad he played a Fleecebane line, actually, because it makes this Hanger Back look a little bit better. Play this bad boy, and then I think we're going to take three from an attack. It looks like he has something of a transitional sideboard, so your opponent, so the control deck boards in all of these counters and boards out all their removal, and then you just play a 3-3 and attack. It's the idea. I'm not sure if I'm going to Epiphany or activate Hanger Back. Boonsader. Well, now I'm probably activating Hanger Back. Blocking Boonsader and activating is a pretty good turn. Get a few Blockerinos. He gets to draw a card. We don't have an answer. Just gonna pass here, represent that I have counter magic. Like a Dissolve or something, and just like couldn't cast it because I had to activate my Hanger Back. And then hopefully he doesn't just like cast a Sigil or something. Silk Wrap is sweet. He gets to draw a card and exile a Thopter in this case. Not bad at all. I'm actually in a position where I wish I had Languish in my deck. So I'm just going to cast this and see what we're actually going to draw into here. Clash of Wills, another Hanger Back. I think I'm going to block. Actually, we could take five. Then run out Hanger Back with some mana up. I don't hate that. And then we're representing double blocking the Eidolon. And negate? Okay. Yeah, if we had one more mana, we would definitely run this guy out for two, but we do not. Opponents have four cards in hand. I imagine he would play a five mana enchantment here. Thinking about taking three. Yeah, I'm gonna go down to seven. Next turn we can't really take, because then like Boon Seder starts to be awkward. This turn, I want to be able to activate my the hangar bank that doesn't have Summoning Sickness and still Clash of Wills or negate something, is why I'm not casting the new hangar bank for two. Yeah, he's got some. Just activating the lion. Yeah, that's fine. I think I'm just going to block the lion with the Thopter. I'm going to negate this. I don't think I can deal with that right now. And then one of the really nice things about Hangar Bank is that it gives you colorless blockers after you resolve Ugin, which is just really nice. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6... Okay. Alright, just one more turn of nonsense. We could Sorcery Speed dig here, but we already have our 8th mana for Ugin. We might need all of our mana for Clash of Wills. Like, if our opponent's been trying to play around Clash of Wills, that could end up being really important. I think I block with the larger one. Don't think it really matters. Just getting more blockers. Yeah, it seems like a good time to dig. As good a time as any. Dissolve Hero's Downfall. I want to make sure that I leave enough blockers back for if he's going to, like, flash in a Boon Seder, you know? And he could have Boon Seder plus removal spell. He's only got 3 cards in hand, so it's not like we need to play around everything, but playing around most things makes sense, and even playing around a combination of a couple of things. If you think that's the only way you lose the game, then there's really no reason not to play around it. Anyway, now we have counters and removal spells and whatnot, so we can send in a good number of Thopters. And then have the hanger back hang back so that we can activate it. And then even if he's getting guys back with Starfield of Nyx, doesn't actually do too much. And we still have 9 minutes on the clock, so we're closing this up with plenty of time. Plenty of time on the old Clockerino. Herald of the Pantheon. Yeah, that's fine. I think I'm just going to downtick Ugin. Just so I don't have to deal with his nonsense. Nice. He's at 11. I guess I cast this. And he only has 1 card in hand, so we might as well attack him with everything. Yeah, I've actually played this matchup a few times in real life, and this is very much what happens. Like, you just don't care until you can kill him. There's just not enough of what they're doing. Their removal is only relevant against a small subset of the field. And their draw engine is a little fragile in comparison to what blue is doing with draw spells. And they're playing Nyx, Fleece, Ram. I don't really get that. Like, if I was designing an enchantment deck, I would probably want it to be robust against multiple archetypes. I think it would actually just look like Green Devotion with some Eidolons thrown in. Eidolon and Courser are so good together. And if you just have Eidolon, the whole thing makes a little bit less sense. Well, anyway, that's just one matchup. One matchup of many. So this is a 4-round daily event, so I'll see you guys in round 2.